of the climate march. Again, I spent 3 days or 3 months in Brooklyn living off this rooftop. Didn't have a place to stay, but I knew that I had to be there because it was a once in a lifetime opportunity. So I did whatever I had to do in order to get the job done. Worked till about 4 in the morning every morning, closed down the building, got up at 9 or 10 o'clock and did it all again for 3 months straight. This was my evenings, again, off that rooftop, but this is my view. So I had the full Brooklyn experience. Typically when you have marches, you have what is, people always want to be at the front, you know, people always want to get that shot. We said, fuck that. We got like frontline communities that are happening, so we're going to design this march in a way that tells story, telling fashion. So who's at the front line of the community, climate change, all these things, usually youth, usually, you know, indigenous people or people of color, because we're the ones that have to suffer these effects. So we're on the front lines as that, and this is what was designed. You had the front line community leading everything. You had, the debate was over, you had scientists and religious people who were coming together for the very first time. And if you understand science, you understand religion. It's like water and oil sometimes. But they're willing to march together because they, you know, feel that this is like a global convergence. So the burden is unequal. We're talking about the Rockaways and how that was flooded and how the government response, you know, just was hollow. And so we had the future generations where we had little kids dressed up as superheroes, and they were battling these images of like, what it is, like incinerators and stuff. Pregnant moms that were out there that were actually, you know, had, it was their own section that they had. And that's never been happened before in life. And now, with who is responsible, we get to actually point the finger at these buildings. And we're talking about climate change. We're going after, like, you name it, big oil, any extractive industry, really. But it's not enough to point the finger, because you have to offer a solution, too. And that's kind of about restorative justice, transformative justice, actually. And so while we're actually pointing the finger, what are the solutions? What are we going to do as people? Because it's not enough to just point the finger and say, hey, that's fucked up. You have to actually provide something. We all know it's messed up. So now we get a chance to do that. You know, we had union workers that were there. We had people that were actually involved in, you know, they had organizations, renewable energy. So that's what we kind of designed the march as. And then everything else fell into place at the end. So these are some of the core groups. There's probably about 7 or 8 of us that were really at the head of all the art that you saw there. And I personally was managing all the art, physically almost touched every piece that went out. So, like I said, it was a once in a lifetime opportunity. And my cousin Mahela and her beautiful children, again, we're using parishes. What did that look like when they got designed? You know, the Rockaways, more inflatables here. Another parachute banner. And this is a bike group. They designed these elaborate structures. They were talking about ending fossil fuels. And what that is, you know, relating that back to the dinosaurs and stuff. So this is the beginning of the march. Painting all these banners, you know, you have children right here that are the front lines of the community. And, you know, this is before the march even happened. We're all waiting. Part of the frontline community is also indigenous communities. We have 6 coal-fired incinerators that that surround us, our Navajo nation. And being at the forefront means that, you know, we suffer these health effects, as, you know, my mom and Amanda had both said earlier. So we're at the forefront of this, because there's no way that you could put 6 incinerators around Phoenix and it'd be okay. But yet we're gonna do it to another marginalized group. Now, that's not real, like, it's just not right. And so this is another part of the indigenous contingent right here at the front line. We have water, we have earth, we have fire, putting these together. Indigenous rights protect us all. stop CO2 colonialism. More indigenous women, they're powerful organs like them. Terra, there's a Guadalupe statue too. Another papier-mâché statue. And so as we go through this, you can kind of see a lot of the art that was developed, and you know, it all came out of this building. And so you had almost 500,000 people show up. And that's huge, it's never happened before. And just to be a part of that core process, as an indigenous person, you know, being an artist, I would have never done that, you know, or art could have taken it. So again, you see more pictures. I mean, it was huge. More inflatables. Science book. Did this huge, like 12, 15 foot chalkboard, talking about the debate solvers. You know, science stands for climate action. So we created all that stuff. And then Veterans for Peace, who I'm a part of as well. And so you see all this art. And at one point, I was rolling with the indigenous world. But I broke away and I wandered backwards to the crowd, and I got to see everything that I did, and just to see it all pass me. And I can't explain that feeling, because all of the stuff, I mean, we've been working on months and months before, and now you have 500,000 people representing what you helped create. And so, following that, in line with the climate march, we were talking about pointing the finger. A lot of what we're finger pointing goes back to Wall Street, the capitalist system that we have. And how do we address that as people coming together in unity? We see what's going on with these corporations and what they're trying to do to us. And he said no. And so, again, you have the greatest artists, movement artists in the world were here. And I got to bang with them, like I said, every day. This is David Sullivan. Anybody remember Seattle 99, the WTO? You guys remember that? It's huge. Huge. That guy was the general. He divided up and gridded out the whole city and created, everyone was underneath him. Created the ways to keep the police out. And they were being chased and barricaded and blocked, and you know, he was behind all this. He was also an artist too. You had Seth Dabakin up there from World War III, another great, great artist. And so this is what you had that was there. Seth Dabakin, he does stencil work, amazing artist. So here we are, like working together to create this imagery. When you look at it, it's simple. It's really just simple. You know, the tide is rising because fossil fuels are burning. You know, the fist going into capitalism. You know, this is all happening in space. And right here in the back, we have what is a 300-foot banner that we were doing. Nobody's ever done a 300-foot banner before. Well, that wasn't until Paris just recently. We did one bigger. But, yeah. As that's going on, I'm screen printing images right here. And so, yeah, there it is. This is what it looks like on top of it. It says capitalism equals climate chaos. Because under capitalism, somebody has to suffer. In order for you to get a profit, somebody has to suffer. You may have like some sort of like internal dialogue or whatever about that, shut it off. Because somebody has to suffer under a capitalistic model. So, that's what we're saying. Capitalism equals climate chaos. Flood of Wall Street. And that was on our tent. This is the night before. This is my friend Artur. Again, we're doing more inflatable sculptures. So, what we're trying to do is tell a story here. I actually made one Rolling Stone, and this is prepping for the actual Flood of Wall Street. As you see, this is a carbon bubble. And how much carbon can you put into the air where life can't be sustained? It's that's the message behind this. Again, creating spectacle in order to get your message across. So, as we're, this is the front of the march, we're moving towards Wall Street, and cops are everywhere, they're trying to stop this. They see this, and they all start gravitating towards it. Oh no, you can't come here. Hey, give me that. You know, you're under arrest. You're under, you know, all we're doing is marching. You know, we just have a banner that it doesn't look like anything else. So, it's kind of what we're, this is in the middle of all that, navigating through cops. Running down Broadway with this huge carnival. I mean, you should have seen the looks on the people's faces as they're trying to go to work. They're just in traffic. All of a sudden, they get stopped. Then you see this going over your car. Like, you get out of the car, you just look suddenly your faces, and just like, this thing's rolling through traffic. But again, it has our message. Our message and our target was Wall Street. What is the target? When we think about Wall Street, what images come to mind? Well, we're going to go after that image. We're looking for the gold. We're looking for that image of Wall Street. Because we're going to smash this right over. So, right here, we actually did that. And you can see all the cops come over trying to protect that gold. Look at all this. These barricades that are here. Trying to protect that fold. What does that tell you? They're playing right into our narrative. Right, you know? Because the system is protecting this. They don't want this. They don't want anything around that. So they didn't know about it, but we had already planned this out. So as, you know, everything's starting to develop, you know, they're playing right into our hand.
Right on.
Imagery about the carbon bubble, and in fact, after we did this, the cops took knives to this thing, and they popped it, and they were just crunching it up and everything like that. We're like, good, we played right into our narrative. But we got another one. So. Second one. And we're actually moving this through, again, Broadway, on our way to Wall Street. And this thing's hitting everything. You know, it's like, cops don't even know what to do. They're chasing this thing. The streets are full of protesters. They're trying to get at this. But the protesters are hitting this thing around, too. And, you know, you have sharp objects everywhere. And so, trying to kind of keep it safe. Find democracy now. This is a shot. We actually had to cut that banner in half so we could fit it into some other imagery. But this is from one of the buildings. And we had stayed there for a little bit, but then we're moving on to the Wall Street. As we get to Wall Street, we're met by riot cops, full gear. Four lines of them. Being at the end of them, you got horse cops. All we're doing is protesting. You know? We just have different ways of doing it. And the cops were actually trying to stop us from getting there. You know, all we're trying to do is deliver a message. Again, playing into our narrative. You can see them back here. This is where the horse cops are coming. Many lines of cops. And this guy right here took it upon himself to start macing everyone. I got it in the face here, but as he did that, he also got his friends here, these other cops. And so it became a battle. We were actually trying to take out the barricades, and we were succeeding at some point, and then they all started moving in. And we decided to sit because it started getting dangerous. And so we had blue smoke going along with like the imagery as well. This is what it looked like. And then we had people that were staying and resisting. So capitalism has no solutions to climate change. Again, going back to capitalism. We were blocked on both sides. This was on one side of the street, Broadway. All the riot cops in full gear were on the other side, and they started coming at us this